course, my brothers, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wal'aqibatu lilmuttaqeen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil mursaleen. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa tabi'een. ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد ولكل وجهة هو موليها فاستبقوا الخيرات وقال الله تعالى عز وجل وسارعوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم وجنة وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بادروا بالأعمال الصالحة فتكون فتن كقطع الليل المظلم يصبح الرجل مؤمنا ويمسي كافرا ويمسي مؤمنا ويصبح كافرا يبيع دينه بعرض من الدنيا يبيع دينه بعرض من الدنيا أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام وعن أنس رضي الله تعالى عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ثلاث من كن فيه وجد حلاوة الإيمان أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما وأن يحب المرء لا يحبه إلا لله وأن يكره أن يعود في الكفر كما يكره أن يقذف في النار أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام رواه البخاري صدق الله وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم رب زدني علما يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد Respected علماء الكرام Respected Hufaz al-Kiram, respected elders, young friends, and my honorable sisters listening at home, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's an honor once more for a humble servant like myself who have been given the opportunity by Shaykh Muhammad Hafizahullah to come and share and spare some moments in Masjid Umar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him for giving me this opportunity. May Allah ta'ala increase his knowledge, his age, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him a means of guidance for all of us. In Islam, nowadays, we are lacking in one thing. Many a times we know the value of certain things and we give it that respect. Many a times we know that certain things are sour and dangerous. We abstain from them for our own benefit. Let's take honey for example. Everybody knows that honey is something that is sweet. It's contrary to something that's sour. The taste of honey, everybody knows. And what benefits lie in honey, subhanallah. Allah has mentioned that in the Qur'an as well, subhanallah. And regarding honey, if you use it and utilize it in a certain way, it could be a means of medicine as well. And modern science today are preparing medicine with abstracts of honey. Because there is shifa and there is cure. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put into that honey that power, which is min janibillah, it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This honey, even if you put it in something that is sour, it will make it sweet. Subhanallah. The same honey, when you want to make your child drink some medicine, you give it something sweet afterwards, so it doesn't remember the taste. In the same way, many a times our parents, after giving us some medicine, they give a spoon of honey. But this sweetness of honey, many a times we want to taste it, but we are not capable of tasting it any longer. There's a limit. A person might not be able to afford buying honey, so therefore he can't taste honey. A person maybe has reached such an age where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been given a test and he has been given some illness which he can't take honey any longer. He wants to, he can buy the best honey in the world, but maybe he can't be able to take it. He can't taste it. But there is one thing, subhanallah, whether ill, whether old, whether young, whether rich, whether poor, you can all taste that, inshaAllah. And that is the taste of Iman, subhanallah. La ilaha illallah. But there are certain things that if we do, only then we will be able to taste the halawatul iman, the sweetness of iman. Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in a sahih hadith narrated by Hazrat Anas radiyallahu ta'ala an, mentioned in the book al-Bukhari. Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ وَجَدَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. He has told us the way. Three things. If a person possesses these three qualities, then he will be able to taste the sweetness of Iman. Don't we all want to feel that, inshaAllah? InshaAllah. The taste of Iman. Whether the taste of Iman, like some ulama have commentated, be in the literal sense, that you will be able to feel the taste in your mouth as you feel the taste of honey and as you feel the taste of a sweet. Subhanallah. This is the extreme level of Iman, subhanallah. May Allah grant us that, inshaAllah. But there is a lower level as well. And the lower level of the sweetness of Iman is a person, subhanallah. Allah gives that person more hidayah. He gives him more, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives that person more guidance to do more righteous deeds, inshaAllah. And then he doesn't see what is in front of him. But whatever is haq, he will say the haq. Whatever is right, he will stand up for justice. He will prevail what is justice. Make sure, فَإِذَا جَاءَ الْحَقِّ وَزَحَقَ الْبَاطِلِ, that when the haq will prevail, the batil will go away, inshaAllah. This halawatul iman, how can we possess this? We can't go to buy from any shopkeeper, can we, or can we? If there is a price that I can give you, inshaAllah, maybe we can go and buy it. But it's not that easy, my brothers. My dear sisters in Islam, it's not so easy. We have to earn this halawatul iman. And these three qualities, which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned in this hadith, we have to try and gain these qualities. Number one, أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما. Who do we love? We love Beckham, do we? Maybe Owen? Maybe Madonna? Maybe Michael Jackson? Maybe somebody else who I don't know. We love, we make icons of personalities. We maybe love our wives, which we should do. I'm not saying we hate our wives, but there's a certain level, there's a difference. Of loving our wife has the right to be loved. And the wife has to give love also to the husband, you know, it's vice versa. That's only one way traffic. And this love of husband and wife is also part of Iman, subhanAllah. So what I'm saying, we love many people, we love many things. But the most love should be for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أن يكون الله ورسوله, that Allah and his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should be the most beloved to you than anything else in the whole world. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in another hadith, لا يؤمن أحدكم, لا يؤمن أحدكم, none of you can be a complete mu'min. You cannot reach the level of complete iman. حتى أكون من وحده والناس أجمعين, أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, until he loved me more than his children, than his family, than his parents, than the whole of mankind. So condition number one, if we want to taste the sweetness of iman, we will have to love Allah the most. We will have to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the most. We will have to make sure all other love is secondary. Love which is jais. I'm not talking about haram. That love which you are, which you should give. Nowadays people say, I'm in love. But unfortunately that's not real love. They say that, but they don't really mean that, because it's just, I think, ambitions and anxieties which take over. Because if it was true love, then there would be a bond between the two. And if it was true love, then like Rasulullah says, that لم تر للمتحابين مثل النكاح. And if there was true love and true bond, then there would be nothing else than to do nikah, which is the Islamic way. But unfortunately, people date people after marriage. Allah save us, my brothers in Islam. So I was saying the first and foremost thing by which we can gain the sweetness of Iman is we should love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the most. How can we do that? We have to love Allah by acting on His injunctions. How can we show the love of Allah? We can show the love of Allah by following the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is not what I'm saying. This is not what any Tom, Dick and Harry is saying. This is what Allah is saying in the Qur'an. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ظُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُرٌ رَحِيمٌ. But if you make a claim that you really love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the people, tell them, follow my ways. If you follow the ways of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then the true love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be gained. The condition of gaining the love of Allah is to have the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you do not have the love of Rasulullah, and how can we have the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We follow his ways. We adopt his sunnah. We feel pride. We feel proud of following the way of Rasulullah. We feel proud of having a lihya, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We feel proud of adorning the sunnah dress of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We feel proud of walking the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walks. We feel proud of doing all our actions according to the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. And then in a true sense, we will be able to gain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, our love is false love. Allah save us, my brothers in Islam. It's the quality of a munafiq. What we say something, and we do something different. We say, we love Allah. We say we love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but unfortunately our lives are contrary to the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our transactions, our dealings, our way of life, our social way of life, our mu'ashara, our conduct, our akhlaq, all is contrary to the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How can we claim to be muhibbul Rasul and muhibbullah? This is a false claim. So I was saying, number one, أَن يَكُونَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا سِوَهُمَا. InshaAllah, we will gain Islam, inshaAllah. We will surpass the love of Allah and the love of Rasulullah over all love, inshaAllah. Allah give us the tawfiq, inshaAllah. Secondly, أن يحب المرء لا يحبه إلا لله سبحان الله. That a person, when he loves somebody, when he loves a brother, he only loves that Muslim for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not for any worldly benefits, not for any worldly gains, but the sole purpose of that love is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why our Nabi Paak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in another hadith, من أحب لله وأبغض لله وأعطى لله ومنع لله فقد استقبل الإيمان. Whosoever has these four qualities, number one, he loves somebody, but he loves him for the sake of Allah. Number two, he hates somebody, but he hates him for the sake of Allah. But nowadays, we love a non-Muslim, and we hate a Muslim. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. We'll have more love for the Susan on the street, and the Michael on the street. We'll feel proud. مارو شكرا تو My chokri to Susan hati for it. My daughter goes around with Susan, you know, she's a very nice girl. And, or whatever, non-Muslim name. And they feel proud of it. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. They feel proud that my son and daughter is socializing with a non-Muslim. Am I, if I'm wrong, tell me, my brothers. Isn't this the reality out there? We won't like our sons and daughters to go to a Muslim house, maybe. You see, I'm talking in general, not saying the people that are listening to the talk doing this, but we're talking at a general view. That majority of the times we see our parents, you know, many a times parents feel that, oh, I'm not going to send because if she goes there and then this will happen, that will happen, it's better she goes to a non-Muslim house. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Anyway, if we love somebody, we should love them for the sake of Allah. And if we hate somebody, who have enmity with somebody, it should be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, you have a grudge with somebody. I'm not going to talk to that person. Why? He's done this to me. Remember, مَنْ هَجَرَ أَخَاهُ فَوْقَ ثَلَاثٍ فَمَا تَدَخَلَ النَّارِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. Remember, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, whosoever leaves relationships, doesn't talk to his Muslim brethren, for more than 3 days, without a shari'i reason, without a shari'i reason, that person will be termed as a kafir. He will go into Jahannam. Allah save us, my brothers in Islam. Nowadays, little things happen. We stop talking with people. Little things, minor issues. A Muslim should be forgiving each other. Overlook mistakes. No. If a non-Muslim makes a mistake, oh, it's okay, no problem. But if a Muslim makes a mistake, no. I'm not going to talk to that person for the rest of my life. If it's a Muslim, you know, we see the Sahaba Sirah. We see that the Sahabi left relationships with his son. Why? Because that son of his, it contradicted the teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was not any worldly benefit. Many a times, our relationships are for worldly benefits, and they, when they break up, when our ties break, they are for worldly things as well. Allah save us. If we love, we love for Allah. If we have adawah and booth and hatred, we should do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not any other purpose. Whoever gives, should give for the sake of Allah. And whoever doesn't give, then he should not give in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he sees that there is harm of deen, fair enough. If a person has these four qualities, then his iman is complete. So, the second quality, and if we take that into our lives, inshallah, we can have the taste of the sweetness of iman, and that is what? We love somebody for the sake of Allah. And the third thing, Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, is something which is to do with us at this present time and the present situation of the Muslim Ummah in the whole world. And that is, أَنْ يَكْرَحَ وَأَنْ يَكْرَهَ أَنْ يَعُودَ فِي الْكُفْرِ كَمَا يَكْرَهُ أَنْ يُقْضَفَ فِي النَّارِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. That a person dislikes, hates, returning to kufr, like a person would dislike being thrown into the fire of hell. Now we see around us today, so much fitna, and in this day of destruction, and this environment of fitna and turbulence, and mischief, every step we take, we have to be very cautious. We have to be very vigilant. We have to make sure kufr is out there to snatch our iman. You know, many a times people say that, oh, you know, Mawlana, I get waswasa. Give me some nuskha so I can light one, my waswasa can go away. Some sahaba, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, once came to the majlis of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I get waswasa, I get thoughts. Certain thoughts come into my mind. And today, I got such thoughts that, you know, I would prefer dying than to say this in front of you, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the nearest meaning, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Abu Bakr, you also get these thoughts? He says, Na'am, I also get these thoughts. Are you sure you get these thoughts? He says, Yes, I do get these thoughts. Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Zaka sarihul iman. This is the sign of iman, subhanallah. Shaitan is not going to go to a person where he can't get anything. He's going to come to us. He's going to put thoughts in our minds. He's going to come in our salah. He's going to try and deviate us from the straight path. He's not going to go to a kafir. He's already deviated that person. He's got nothing to do with that. They're on their own path. So the shaitan and the wasawis are going to come to us. But we have to tackle those wasawis. We have to face those wasawis. And we have to go through the struggle of overcoming those wasawis. And this is all part of iman, subhanallah. ذَلَكَ الصَّرِيحُ الْإِيمَانِ. This is the clear iman, Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says. So, like I was mentioning, that nowadays, we see many things. Everywhere we go, we see kufr is at its extremes. And at this time and age, we have to make sure that we keep our iman intact. And the only way we can do that, the only way we can do that is get guidance from Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Many a times, you know, there are three means of knowledge. Number one, our five senses. Through our senses, we can gain knowledge. Number two, our intellect. But to a certain level, our intellect also gives up. You know this wall? If I want to say what color this wall is, if I close my eyes, will I be able to know? No? So I will need my senses. So the senses to a certain level give up. So then I will need to open my eyes. I can see the color. Now I can see the wall. Who built this wall? I can't tell it with my five senses. I will need to use my intellect. Who built this wall? I need to find out. Now to a certain extent, I can find that out. But if I need to find out, how can this same wall be used for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how can I please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the same wall? I cannot know that without going to the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is where the wahi comes. That is where the teachings of Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes. We need to go to the guidance of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he has said to us, بَادِرُوا بِالْأَعْمَالِ الصَّالِحَةِ. Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, hasten towards righteous deeds. فَتَكُونُ fitan. For there is lot of fitna and turbulence to come. فَقِطَعِ اللَّيْلِ الْمُظْلِمِ. Like the darkness, a portion of the dark night. يُصْبِحُ الرَّجُلُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا. A person will be a mu'min in the morning. Allah save us. He'll become a kafir by the evening. وَيُمْسِي مُؤْمِنًا وَيُصْبِحُ كَافِرًا. A person will be a mu'min in the evening. When it's morning, he becomes a kafir. Allah save us, my brothers. And then further, Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, يَبِيعُ دِينَهُ بِعَرَضٍ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا. He will sell his faith for the sake of some worldly benefits. لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوتَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. In another hadith, Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, بَادِرُوا بِالْأَعْمَالِ السَّبْعَةِ. Hasten towards righteous deeds of seven things before the occurrence of the other seven. بَادِرُوا بِالْأَعْمَالِ السَّبْعَةِ. هَلْ تَنْتَظِرُونَ إِلَّا فَقْرًا مُنْسِيَةً. And the Prophet ﷺ says, are you really waiting for such poverty which will make you regardless of your worship? Allah save us, my brothers. Allah save us. We see the situation of the world today. كان الفقر أن يكون كفرا. That poverty can lead a person towards kufr. Allah save us, my brothers. So Nabi Pak Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saying, if you have got riches, are you waiting to become poor? هل تنتظرون إلا فقرا منسيا? Are you waiting for such poverty which will make you, which will take you away from the worships of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? أو غنى مضغيا? Are you waiting for such richness which will deviate you from the right path? Which will make you the baghi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Which will make you the rebellion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are you waiting for such richness? That this wealth is given to you, and that same wealth, you don't use it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? هَلْ تَنْتَظِرُونَ إِلَّا فَقْرًا مُنْسِيًا أَوْ غِنًا مُضْغِيًا أَوْ مَرَضًا مُفْسِدًا? Are you waiting for such illness which will make you disabled? Which will disable you? Are you waiting for that? You have got siha. You are healthy. Do what you can now. Be hasty. Don't say, I'm going to do it tomorrow, because tomorrow might never come. هَلْ تَنْتَظِرُونَ إِلَّا فَقْرًا مُنْسِيًا أَوْ غِنًا مُضْغِيًا أَوْ مَرَضًا مُفْسِدًا أَوْ حَرَمًا مُفَنِّدًا? Are you waiting for such old age in which you will become mentally incapable? Are you waiting for such old age? أَوْ مَوْتًا مُجْهِزًا? Are you waiting for sudden death? That death will come upon you and then you will do righteous deeds? هَلْ تَنْتَظِرُونَ إِلَّا فَقْرًا مُنْسِيًا أَوْ غِنًا مُطْغِيًا أَوْ مَرَضًا مُفْسِدًا أَوْ حَرَمًا مُفَنِّدًا أَوْ مَوْتًا مُجْهِزًا أَوْ الدَّجَّال? Are you waiting for the Antichrist? Are we waiting for Dajjal? So when Dajjal will come, then we will do righteous deeds. فَشَرُّ غَائِبٍ يُنْتَظَرُ فَشَرُّ غَائِبٍ يُنْتَظَرُ Nabi Pak Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that Dajjal is the worst of the things which are apprehended. أَوِ السَّاعَ هَا وَمَا Qiyama is very terrifying and very bitter. So these seven things Nabi Pak Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has told us, the conclusion is that these fitnas will come in such successions, in quick successions, one after the other, after the other, after the other, and they will want to take away our Iman. So how can we save our Iman? We can save our Iman by doing righteous deeds. By doing a'mali saliha. Be hasting towards good deeds. Not say, oh, I'm not going to do it today, I'll be doing it tomorrow, I'll do it later on. No. If you have got the opportunity today, do it today, because you might not get a chance tomorrow. And remember, kufr is working in all forms. And this is sign of qiyamah. Nabi Pak Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions a hadith. Subhanallah. Yushikul umam. An tada'a alaykum. كما تداءى العاقلة إلى قصعتها سبحان الله. Nabi Pak Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has mentioned that sign. This is something not for us. It's an eye-opener for us. He's mentioning some of the signs of Qiyamah. And Nabi Pak Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is saying here that there will be a time on the Ummah. A time will come when the kafir and the non-believers and the hypocrites, they will be calling each other against you. كَمَا تَدَاءَ الْآكِلَةُ إِلَىٰ قَصْعَتِهَا Like a person who is going to dine at somebody's house, a person who is base person, when he goes to somebody's house to eat, the host, when a host invites somebody, the guest, like a person who is going to consume the food, like they call each other, come on, come on, come, eat with us. And they force each other to eat with them. This is how kufr will be forcing each other. All the forces will be going against the mu'min, against the Muslim. These forces will be calling each other against us. كَمَا تَدَاعَ الْآكِلَةُ إِلَىٰ قَصْعَتِهَا Like they call them to the dining table. A Sahabi, he was shocked of hearing this. فَقَالَ قَائِلٌ وَمِنْ قِلَّةٍ نَحْنُ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Will really this happen? Is this because we will be less in number? Will we be less in number at the time when people will be calling the world against us? Every corner of the world will be against the mu'min, a person who follows the sharia. People will look at them and they will say, this person is something different. He's not human, he's inhumane. فَحَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. This is gonna happen, it's happening. It's happening in front of our own eyes, my brothers. Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he said cannot be wrong, subhanallah. What he said can never be wrong, because what he said was also wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمِنْ قِلَّةٍ نَحْنُ يَوْمَئِذٍ. Is it because we will be less in numbers? Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, بَلْ أَنْتُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ كَثِيرٌ. No. You will not be less in number. You will be more in number. You will surpass all other nations. Let's look at the latest statistics. What do they show? You must have heard. About a month ago, the latest statistics was that the majority of any religion, followers of any religion existing in this world today, before they used to say Christians, now they say Muslims. This has been quoted in the paper of the Daily Junk. So they even accept now that the majority of the followers of any religion in the world is Muslim. وَلَكِنَّكُمْ كَثِيرٌ. بَلْ أَنْتُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ كَثِيرٌ. You will be more in number. But what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? وَلَكِنَّكُمْ غُثَاءٌ. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. But you will be like the foam, you know, in a sea on the top of the water, the foam. كَغُثَاءِ السَّيْلِ. Like the rubbish. When the waves come, and when they go back, when there's been water coming in and going out, and the water that goes back and it leaves that rubbish behind, Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, this will be our value. This will be the value. بَلْ أَنْتُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ كَثِيرٌ وَلَكِنَّكُمْ غُثَاءٌ كَغُثَاءِ السَّيْلِ. And then further Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَلَيَنْزَعَنَّ اللَّهُ مِنْ صُدُورِ عَدُوِّكُمْ الْمَهَابَةَ مِنْكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take away from the hearts of your enemy your fear. The kafir will not fear the mu'min. He will do what he wants, how he wants, however he wants. He will not be worried about the mu'min. Isn't that happening today? Tell me, brothers. وَلَيَنْزَعَنَّ اللَّهِ مِنْ صُدُورِ عَدُوِّكُمْ الْمَهَابَةَ مِنْكُمْ. But not only that, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do one other thing. وَلَيَقْذِفَنَّ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمُ الْوَهَنِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put in your heart wahan. فَقَالَ قَائِلٌ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ مَا الْوَهَنِ. A person inquired to Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is wahan, ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said two things, حب الدنيا وكراهية الموت. The love of the dunya and dislike of death, subhanallah. Now you tell me today, the mu'min, the Muslim of today, isn't he fearing death? The Muslim of today has been engrossed in the love of the world to such an extent that he is ready to sell his own deen. La ilaha illallah. May Allah save us, my brothers in Islam. So let's conclude the talk of today by saying, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to do righteous deeds. Because we have to prepare for our death. And the way we can do that, Alhamdulillah, Imam Ghazali alayhim al-Rahma, The last quotation I will mention, inshallah, we will finish thereafter. Imam Ghazali has told us the way how to do this. How can we do righteous deeds? How can we become mu'min a kamil? Imam Ghazali alayhim ar-Rahmah, he says, a Muslim, when he wakes up in the morning, he should do musharata. He should do musharata, an agreement with his soul. Make an agreement. Like we make an agreement, he should make an agreement with his soul. Right. You're not going to go here and there today. You're going to be online. Your hands, you're not going to do any haram. You're not going to consume haram. You're going to make sure your gaze are low. You're going to make sure you don't walk towards haram. You're going to make sure you don't talk any haram. You don't listen to haram. You don't see haram. And you make an agreement with your soul that if you do this, you're going to be punished. If you do this, you're going to be punished. So you make an agreement with your soul. And after that, when you go to your workplace, when you go to your businesses, when you go into the market, when you go for shopping, when you go to fulfill your family chores, then you do muraqabah. Second thing, you have supervision. What are you doing? Be conscious. Be conscious of your amal. Do muraqabah. So first you have already made this agreement. Don't break the agreement. Don't go against the agreement. Because you know you have to pay a penalty at the end. So what are you going to do now? When you make an agreement, you make sure that you don't go against the agreement. You go according to each and every clause. Because you know that if you go against the clause, then you might get a fine. Yeah? So same way. You make an agreement, and now you're going to do supervision. You're doing supervision, night time comes. When night time comes, you do the third thing, which is muhasabah. Which is muhasabah. Now you take accounts. You become an accountant. You sit down and say, right, mate, what did you do all day today? You spoke lies. Acha, you looked at the woman. Think now, from the morning till the evening. What did you do? Acha, did I look at the TV? Did I see haram women on there? Did I listen to music? Did I do this? Did I do this? Were my transactions halal or haram? So we make muhasabah. Are you agreeing to me? We agree to this agreement. The first thing is musharata. Second thing, muraqabah, supervision. Third thing, muhasabah. So we're going to take accounts. And now you've taken accounts, or you made an agreement before, if you do anything wrong, then now the fourth thing, which is muaqabah, punishment, penalty now. So the punishment is, if I did this thing, I'm going to pray 2 rakat of nafal namaz. I'm going to pray tahajjud namaz. I'm going to wake up for tahajjud. And remember, my brothers, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept in tahajjud, subhanallah, only those people know who pray tahajjud. Two things our Hazrat mentions. Hazrat Mu'ayyad Mutala Sahib always used to tell us, two things. If you adopt these two things, inshallah you will be successful. One is you love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with madness. When you love Rasulullah, you're going to do everything according to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Aap sallallahu alaihi wasallam ke saath walihana muhabbat. Aur dusra kaam, raat ke waqt uthkar Allah se mangne wale ban jaye. Second thing is wake up in the latter part of the night and ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the last thing is muaqabah. I'm not going to give you any more punishment anymore. With the time, I will conclude with these last words. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq, the speaker more than the listeners, that we act upon the Quranic injunctions and the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ الْكَرِيمِ. سبحان الله وبحمده. سبحانك الله وبحمده. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير. اللهم لا مانع لما أعطيت ولا معطي لما منعت ولا ينفذ الجد منك الجد. يا رب صلي وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم اللهم صل على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم كلما ذكره الذاكرون وصل على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم كلما غفل عن ذكره الغافلون اللهم ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين فانصرنا على القوم المنافقين فانصرنا على القوم الظالمين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا وأكرمنا ولا تهنا وأكرمنا ولا تهنا وأعطنا ولا تحرمنا وأعطنا ولا تحرمنا وآثرنا ولا تؤثر علينا وآثرنا ولا تؤثر علينا وانصرنا ولا تنصر علينا وأعنا ولا تعن علينا وامكر لنا ولا تمكر علينا وامكر لنا ولا تمكر علينا وأعفنا واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا وانصرنا على القوم الظالمين وأصلح لنا شأننا كله ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يرحمنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم